We all know where water comes from. But have you ever wondered where water goes once it reaches the ground? Although it might stay still, water never stops moving through the earth. When water meets land, they merge together. This union is called wetlands. Lakes, rivers, swamps, floodplains, estuaries, mangroves, peatlands, shorelines, coral reefs. These are examples of wetlands. These environments are an important part of our daily lives and contribute to our well-being. They naturally filter and store water, making it available to the living world, including us. Wetlands are therefore extraordinarily rich and biodiverse ecosystems where life is bursting. They are home to 40% of the world's plants and animals. Half of all bird species depend on wetlands, and two-thirds of fish breed or live there. Wetlands are all around the planet, yet only cover 6% of the emerged land. They are our most valuable ecosystems and play a crucial role in sustaining life on our planet. However, wetlands are being lost at an alarming rate. Since 1900, two-thirds of these vital areas have been destroyed.
Seeing the need to protect wetlands and ensure their wise use, governments established in 1971 the Convention on Wetlands, which is the world's first international treaty focusing on a single ecosystem.
Today, 50 years later, the convention has been adopted by 171 countries. Through the designation of protected areas, the implementation of effective policies, and the sharing of knowledge, the convention enables countries to take action to protect their wetlands and use them wisely. Wetlands provide clean water, essential for human consumption and production of food. They protect us from storms and floods. They store more carbon than all the world's forests combined, making them critical for addressing climate change. And importantly, more than 1 billion people living in cities and rural communities in all countries of the world depend on wetlands for their livelihood.
We cannot afford to lose more wetlands. They are a powerful nature-based solution to the many challenges the world is facing. Taking action now for wetlands is foundational for creating the future we want.
Over the past 50 years, the Convention on Wetlands has helped us better understand the value of these precious ecosystems. Through increasing awareness, knowledge, and action on the ground, the convention provides a clear way forward for taking action for wetlands. Wetlands protect life. Our future depends on wetlands.
Welcome. So I'm very pleased to welcome you today to this event with which we start our celebration for World Wetlands Day. As you know, World Wetlands Day is on the 2nd of February, which is a couple of days, in 2 days. And we are gathering today with a special focus this year on wetlands action for people and nature. And this year, it is particularly important and special because this is the first year when we are celebrating World Wetlands Day as a United Nations International Day. So last year in August, the UN General Assembly adopted a resolution declaring 2nd of February as World Wetlands Day. And this recognition, actually, this declaration by the United Nations reflects the importance of wetlands for people and nature. And we heard in the video the many values and the urgency to take action. And it is very timely also because this year is a very important year for biodiversity, with the expected adoption of the post-2020 Global Biodiversity Framework, which should provide a roadmap for all the countries and for all actors to take action to halt biodiversity. But it is also a year where it is expected that countries are going to take stronger commitments to address climate change. And it is going to be also the year where the Ramsar Convention on Wetlands is going to have its 14th meeting of the Conference of the Parties in China. So action is extremely urgent because wetlands are the most threatened ecosystem today. We have lost in the last 50 years 35% of our wetlands, and we're losing them faster than forests, 3 times faster than forests. At the same time, when we lose these wetlands, we are losing the huge and enormous benefits that they provide for society and to address the many challenges that we have. So wetlands are key for biodiversity, to halt biodiversity loss, because they host 40% of all the species. They're important for climate change because wetlands are the most efficient carbon store and also protect from the impacts of climate change. And they are very important to address the sustainable development agenda by providing livelihoods, food security, among other benefits. So it is really important that we use this World Wetlands Day to raise attention and to take the necessary actions. And this is the theme that we are going to be treating today. So we are very glad to have a distinguished panel that is going to be addressing this important issue. And we are going to have a panel that is going to bring perspective from different sides, from the science, from governmental action at the national level, at the international level, from non-governmental organizations, from different partnerships, from UN agencies, with the idea of seeing what are the challenges and what are the opportunities that wetlands provide to address all these issues. So in this event, we're going to start with the first session, which is about setting the scene to look at the challenges, trends, and actions. Then we're going to have a second session where we are going to focus on the types of actions that we have to reflect and to react to the challenges and opportunities that we have. And then we're going to wrap up. I wanted to say a couple of words also to the audience. We are streaming this event via Zoom, but also via YouTube. We invite you to ask questions so that we can bring them to the panelists. So for that, you need to use in the Zoom the questions and answer section, and in YouTube, the comment section. So please type your comments, and we will be collecting these questions so that we can bring them to the panelists. The event is being translated in French and Spanish so that you have the opportunity to listen to English, French, and Spanish. In YouTube, we can only stream it on English. So with this, we are going to start with our first panel. So the first panel is about status, trends, and actions. And I'm very pleased to introduce our panelists. So we have Dr. Lisa Rebello. Lisa Rebello is the vice chair of the Scientific and Technical Review Panel of the Convention, the SDRP. And she's an expert on wetlands and water, working in the International Institute for Water Management in Colombo, Sri Lanka. We are very honored to have also Vice Minister Cynthia Barzuna, who is the Vice Minister of Water and Coasts in the Ministry of Environment in Costa Rica. In addition to her experiences as minister, she's an expert on environment and urban development. And we're also very honored to have Ambassador Tom Woodruff, who is the United Kingdom Ambassador to the Economic and Social Council. So he's been working and representing the United Kingdom in the United Nations. So welcome to our three panelists. So I'm going to start with Dr. Rebello, Lisa. So being the vice chair of our scientific and technical review panel, it is important to note that the panel just launched the Global Wetlands Outlook Special Edition, And this brings scientific and technical information, very important information about wetlands and the role. So could you please share with the audience which are the highlights and which are the critical wetlands and actions that need to be taken?
Thank you, Martha. So as you said, we've just released an update to the 2018 Global Wetland Outlook. And in that first version, we documented the extent of wetland loss and highlighting the rapid and alarming rate that this has been occurring. So the recently released update has looked further at the implications for the ecological character of wetlands and at what humanity stands to lose if these trends are not halted and reversed. And so the latest report confirms that broadly the picture still remains one of continued wetland loss and that this trend is apparent across most regions. We highlight recent research which has focused on drivers of change in wetlands and which has identified both land use changes and the side effects of pollution linked to this. Biodiversity losses are reported as most strongly linked to these land use changes, and they're unfortunately projected to continue as well as to increase. So water quality pollution also continues as a result of pollution from multiple sources. And of course, the impacts of climate change on wetlands is becoming steadily more apparent. But against these trends, one positive highlight from the report that I'd like to mention is that the improvement in wetland ecological character was found to be linked to implementation of the Convention on Wetlands. And contracting parties which reported on improving state of all wetlands also actually reported implementing a larger than the average number of strategic plan actions. So that does give us some hope. In terms of what types of wetlands are in need of critical action, well, all wetlands unfortunately are affected, and required actions vary according to the drivers of loss and degradation. So wetlands have been particularly impacted by climate change, especially sea level rise, coral reef bleaching as a result of increased sea surface temperatures, and changing hydrology in inland waters is affecting inland wetland types. For some wetland types or regions, we have more information than for others. We know, for example, that Mediterranean wetlands face significantly high climate risk. There are, for instance, huge economic and human threats associated with the loss of coastal wetlands from projected sea level rise, and coastal populations in small island developing states are disproportionately at risk. So these are a few of the points that are summarized in the recently released Global Wetland Outlook.
Thank you, Lisa. So it is really interesting to hear, of course, that the trends continue to be very negative, but you mentioned that there is a connection and a link between the ecological character and the implementation of the convention. Can you tell us a little bit more about what are the drivers of these laws, and why do you think, or does this study shows the importance of taking action nationally, internationally?
Yes, of course. So we find that land use change is the dominant factor affecting freshwater ecosystems, and agricultural expansion is the most widespread form of land use change, with over one third of the terrestrial land surface currently being used for agricultural activities. So the Global Wetland Outlook highlights that over half of all wetlands of international importance are negatively impacted by agriculture. And so the associated costs to wetland health and integrity in turn have direct impacts on food security. So while agriculture ultimately depends on healthy wetlands and adequate water resources, and the damage that unsustainable agricultural practices are having on wetlands will in time rebound negatively on agriculture itself. The report also highlights that the loss of wetlands is being accelerated by the impacts of climate change and is actually occurring faster than anticipated. So the rising sea levels and changing hydrology are all accelerating. The new information we have on the rate of climate change emphasizes the urgency of wetland management and restoration. And so wetlands provide services related to climate change mitigation and adaptation, disaster risk reduction, energy, food security, as well as the supply of many materials. And wise use of wetlands is really critical to global sustainability. If wetlands degrade, their ability to provide for people is reduced. So the wise use of wetlands is an essential component in meeting international targets relating to the biodiversity, climate change, and as well, of course, to sustainable development. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. No, it's very interesting. I think that the example that you provide on agriculture is very telling, because on the one hand side, agriculture is one of the drivers of wetlands loss. And when we lose wetlands, we are affecting agriculture because there is no water for agriculture to be able to sustain, you know, like the demand for food. So it's really interesting to see this connection and why conserving wetlands and restoring wetlands is important for, you know, the sustainability of society all over the world. And it will be then, I'm going to turn to Vice Minister Barzuna. From the Costa Rica perspective, I would like to ask you, first of all, I started my introduction by mentioning this important development of last year when the UN General Assembly declared World Wetlands Day as a UN Day, and Costa Rica was the main proponent of, or the lead proponent of this resolution. Just for the audience, this is an initiative that came out from the Conference of the Parties, that in the meeting that we had in Dubai in 2018, where all the 171 then, now we have 172 contracting parties, agreed, you know, to propose that the UN General Assembly declares the 2nd of February as World Wetlands Day. But then, you know, that was the wish of the parties, and then that had to be put in place, and Costa Rica took the lead. So, Vice Minister, could you tell us a little bit about what the process was and why this has significance in terms of the agenda that Dr. Rebello just described?
Thank you. Yes, I would love to. It is very exciting for us, actually, to have our first World Wetlands Day as United Nations International Day, of course. And I think it's all about, and you mentioned it, Madam Secretary, that it's all about connections. And we feel like sometimes wetlands has been addressed in a separate way, not connected to sustainable cities, not connected to sustainable use of land. And as Dr. Rivella was mentioning, the actual threat is from the growth of our cities and from the growth of our agricultural limits. So in terms of addressing this very important connection between biodiversity, there's no connection sometimes. People do not relate sometimes what happens in the coastal areas with regards to inland and the actions that take place within peatlands, the connection between peatlands and mangroves and seagrass and shorelines and coral reefs. So it all comes up to, we need nature-based solutions, but we need to consider this element not in a separate way, and to put our efforts in protecting this very important blue ecosystems. Dr. Ravel was talking about hydrology. This is one of the key issues that we do need to address in terms of, of course, it is very difficult for many countries to have the accurate information, excuse me, just to address properly what needs to be done in terms of actions. So there's a lot of value for people and nature. We need to raise this conversation. It's really connected to, of course, the NDCs. I think last COP26 was a very blue COP, and I think we all can agree that we need to come up with solutions that are nature-based, ocean-based, and also that we need to be more ambitious. And Ramsar has been for over 50 years that special framework world started, and we can scale it up the conversation by understanding the services that wetlands provide. Of course, we have a global climate ambition that we need to address as well. And blue carbon sequestration, the scientists are telling us that it's just, it's capturing 55 times faster storing this carbon, and it absorbs 10 times more than forest. So for us in Costa Rica, being part of a tropical ecosystem, the threats are there: sea level rise for the Caribbean and our and Central America is a huge threat that we need to address in terms of climate change. So this has to be a recurring dialogue and an ongoing discussion about the services that these wetlands provide. For example, in Costa Rica, we have peatlands, and in Talamanca, where the indigenous peoples have been working to protect this ecosystem. So we have to talk about conservation, but we also have to talk about restoration. And we have to talk about, especially in coastal areas for Costa Rica, it's been quite a challenge. And we have been working with partnerships in order to come up with an ecosystem service payment that will protect these livelihoods, but also create jobs, blue economy, which is something we really need to address as well, to tackle not only climate change, but also to protect and restore these very important ecosystems. And we need to acknowledge that they're very connected. So I think the value it's about people, it's about nature, it's about raising our ambition. We need to address the SDGs, but we also need to address NDCs in order to tackle climate change. This is also about poverty. And you mentioned something very important, and with this, I would like to, because I'm very excited with this subject, but I could go on forever, but urban planning and marine special planning must be part of the discussion as well, because this is where all starts. It's we need to restore, we need to protect, but we also need to focus especially on developing countries, on urban planning and marine special planning, because that will give us the framework that we need to protect these very important ecosystems. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vice Minister. It's really useful to hear your perspective, and also that you could speak for hours. I think that we are all here passionate, and it is really important to see, I think, the point that you made on the connections, and you mentioned connections with agriculture, connections with the management between, you know, like the fresh water and the sea, which is absolutely critical, and the linkage with the urban development, which is also one of the causes of wetlands loss. And at the same time, there are huge opportunities of using sustainable management of wetlands to serve cities. And this can be because of quality of water, it can be to prevent floods, it could be for recreation, so that connection is really important. Vice Minister, would you like to share more about experiences in Costa Rica? You mentioned a particular peatland, but of course, Costa Rica is very much on the front in terms of taking action on wetlands. So do you want to share another example?
I would love to. We have incorporated the goals on conservation and rational use of wetlands in our national decarbonization plan. I think that is something that must be mandatory with regards to every country. The commitments related to conservation of mangroves in our NDCs as well. I think the discussion should always be related to, in terms of Costa Rica, not only we have implemented and made it part of our strategic plan, and also we've committed to a higher ambition in terms of protection, our inventory. We have Jacqueline Rivera, but she's wonderful. She's been working with her team, and we already have that inventory. So it's very difficult to protect something if you don't know what you have. It's also and also want to be I want to make a suggestion that we need to think about education. You cannot preserve, you cannot protect, you cannot restore something if you don't know what's the purpose of it. So we need to focus on environmental education. We need to have this conversation as well, And we need to work, we've been working through partnerships, especially on the coastal area. That has been a very, very good experience because we have scientists, we have communities involved, and involving the communities in the very early stages makes the whole difference, because they know what they're protecting and because they know how, they know their area, they know what's been going on, they can see the changes. I've been talking to women fishermen that now tell me that there's no more fish, that they need to create this biomass, to protect this biomass, to preserve it, that they are, they realize that the nurseries are struggling. They realize that the level, the sea level has risen. They realized that acidification has changed a bit the ecosystems. So they have been there for many years. They know the reality, and they just need the tools to take action, and we need to encourage these actions. And from our point of view, it has been very interesting in Costa Rica going through these partnerships in order to have science, in order to have the appropriate finance mechanisms, which is something we need to discuss with regards to wetlands, what mechanisms are more appropriate. And then, of course, involving the communities in having a global plan so you can have nature-based solutions that not only are ambitious and can tackle climate change, but also involve people and make people the center of the decisions and the solutions. So for us, it has been a very important experience. And also, I would like to mention that it is true that Costa Rica started this whole process in Dubai and the discussion, and we wanted to raise the level, but we had very good partners as well that joined us, nations that wanted to raise this conversation, and hopefully this will help us find a way to have same way as we have discussed in COP26 about having a recurring dialogue every year on ocean-based solutions. I think we do have to raise the discussion on wetlands and have a recurring dialogue that will help us out to create a plan, a global plan, because at the end, we're all connected. It's all about the connection, making the connections of this very important wetlands. And the loss that Dr. Ravello was mentioning, it's quite alarming. And I think through education, we can spread the word to have better solutions and involve more nations.
Thank you, Vice Minister. So it is really interesting to hear all these connections, but you're also touching on some of the mechanisms that we know work. And what Costa Rica is doing, for example, in integrating wetlands into the carbon reduction strategies is really key. You also mentioned the importance of inventories, which is something that the parties in the convention do. We cannot take action if we don't know where to take action. So that's a very important mechanism. Education, the important role of communities and the center, the purpose, as you rightly said, of you know, having people at the center of all action. And you already proposed some very, very interesting initiative that I hope some parties would take, which is to have a global plan for wetlands-based solution. So thank you so much for this. And I wanted to thank you for your leadership in making the reality, the resolution from all the parties in the General Assembly. And as you said, there was a group of countries that worked tirelessly, even you know, within the pandemic, to bring this to be. It was a resolution that was presented with 75 co-sponsors, and of course it was then adopted unanimously. The importance of this is that we are getting to a broader audience. It also means that the United Nations agencies are invited to also celebrate this day. And the Convention Secretariat is going to report to the General Assembly, opening the possibility for more substantive resolutions on wetlands. So thank you Vice Minister, and thank you to Costa Rica for leading that. One of the actions that you touched at different moments was this critical connection between wetlands and climate. And we are very, very honored to have Ambassador Woodruff here, given that the UK was another leader country in terms of hosting the COP26 of the Climate Change Convention, but also nationally. So Ambassador, could you share some, so you have been speaking about this important link between climate and nature, climate and wetlands. Could you please share some of the experience of the United Kingdom at national level, but also perhaps in the second time, if you could tell us a little bit about what it means internationally, what actions can be taken so that we can further this connection that Vice Minister already mentioned, that Lisa, our Dr. Ribeiro also mentioned, in terms of this critical connection between wetlands and climate change.
Thank you, Martha. Yes, of course. Good morning. Good morning to you. Good morning to everybody else. I will do that in a moment, Martha, if I may, but I just wanted to start by saying two other things. Firstly, of course, it's a little bit early, but happy World Wetlands Day. But secondly, I just actually wanted to pick up on your point about the leadership of Costa Rica. And I would just like to say to the Vice Minister, not only on this issue, but I think on the global, on the biodiversity and nature agenda more broadly, your government has shown such remarkable global leadership and really has set the bar so very high, and I think has demonstrated the kind of actions and the kind of leadership that all of us should aspire to. So thank you very much, and it's a great honor to be on a panel with you. So Martha, you asked a little bit about what the UK is doing on wetlands. I want to just preface my remarks by just noting that actually the UK and its overseas territories, I have to say I didn't know this, but the UK and its overseas territories comprise the largest number of Ramsar wetland sites of international importance in the world, apparently 175, which I think just demonstrates the importance of wetlands to the UK, and therefore why it is critical that the UK government is taking action to protect and restore them. For all of the reasons I think that we've heard already this morning, whether that is climate-related, biodiversity-related, to aid against coastal erosion, etc. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what the UK is doing domestically and then touch a little bit about what the UK is doing internationally, but then perhaps come back to your point, Martha, about what more could we do internationally as well, all of us together. So domestically, just a few examples of the things that the UK government has done. Last year, we expanded our blue belt of marine protection around the UK so that 38% of UK waters are now conserved. And that includes the vast majority of our salt marsh and seagrass habitats. And apparently around 2,300 kilometers of the UK's coastline is protected under one of four shoreline management plans, making it the longest protected coastline in Europe. Now those plans, those shoreline management plans, detail how local authorities need to put nature at the very heart of what they are doing to adapt to and manage coastal erosion, flood risks and rising sea levels. They have objectives, I think, acknowledging how they have objectives expanding over 100 years, which I think demonstrates quite how far into the future we are thinking about the importance of these issues. And that is backed up by funding. So in addition, the UK's new £10 million Natural Environment Investment Readiness Fund is supporting a whole range of different projects, including one to create a new UK salt marsh carbon code, which will aim to unlock up to £1 billion worth of investment to restore England's degraded salt marshes. And in addition, our Peatland Restoration Fund and our Nature for Climate Fund have put over £650 million towards woodland creation and peatland restoration. And just earlier this month, the government unveiled the next stages of its plan to reward farmers and landowners for actions which benefit the environment, supporting sustainable food production alongside vital nature recovery and our work towards net zero. And those reforms are the biggest changes to farming and land management in the UK in 50 years. I think picking up on Lisa's point earlier about the interrelatedness with agriculture. And those plans include two new schemes that will bring up to 60% of England's agricultural soil under sustainable management by 2030. and create or restore up to 300,000 hectares of wildlife habitat by 2042, including peat and wetland areas. Now, alongside what we're doing in the UK, we're also supporting other countries in their efforts to restore and protect wetlands. As an example, through the £10 million Blue Forests Initiative, the UK is supporting local communities in Indonesia and Madagascar to protect and reforest over 180,000 hectares of mangrove forests. And that's backed up by further UK funding to support countries from our Blue Planet Fund and the Biodiverse Landscapes Fund. I won't go into detail of those now, but I'm very happy to provide more detail if anyone on the call is interested. Now, I think, Martha, you, in your introductory remarks, talked a little bit about the importance of this year and the various opportunities that are coming up this year, whether that's UNEAR 5.2, whether that's COP15, whether that's, of course, the UN Ocean Summit in June. There's also a French Oceans Conference, I think, next week. There's a one that the Palau is hosting. I think what we need to think collectively is how all of these opportunities can be tied together in a single coherent plan that ensures that the issue of wetlands is receiving suitable prominence in all of those international fora, but that we are building on each step along the way to ensure that more prominence and more concerted action is given to the issue of wetlands. And just picking up again on, I think the Vice Minister raised the importance of nature-based solutions in the fight against climate change. Just on that issue, I think I just wanted to flag that, of course, you know, despite everything that is happening on the ground, there is a lack of common understanding at the multilateral level on the benefits of nature-based solutions. And that has, in the past, limited our collective ability to commit to the necessary action and coordinate our responses in the right manner. So with that in mind, I just wanted to use this opportunity to say that's why the UK very much welcomes the EU's proposed nature-based solutions resolution at UNEAR 5.2 next month, and why we want to work with all partners around the world to ensure that consensus on that resolution can be reached, so there is a common understanding of what we mean by nature-based solutions and why they are so important. And so I would encourage everybody on this call, if you're from governments, and if you're not, to lobby your governments to support that EU initiative so that common understanding can be reached. So with that, Martha, thank you very much. It's been a real honor to be here, and I'm very much looking forward to the rest of the conversation this morning. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. You were right to mention the active actions that the UK has been taking on the Ramsar Convention, and it is correct. I confirm that the UK is a country that has designated the biggest number of wetlands of international importance, which actually is a recognition also of the wealth that the United Kingdom has in terms of these very important ecosystems. And it was very interesting to hear the connections that you are making also with the financial part. And I think that is critical, as you were saying, and it is really encouraging. And I encourage here also the other governments and other institutions, organizations that are interested in this, because we need finance in order to really make the level of change. We need integration, as we have been hearing from all the panelists in the different agendas. And we need specific action from wetlands. And Ambassador, you were very inspiring in terms of showing the level of action that the United Kingdom is taking in terms of also in situ, you know, type of measures, such as the protection of the coastline and the integration into policies, such as in agriculture. I was also very interested to hear the ideas that you have in terms of how to move forward and how can we build more awareness and understanding of the importance of wetlands as a win-win solution. So thank you for highlighting this connection with the EU nature-based solution resolution that is going to come to UNEA in a couple of weeks. Can I just ask you perhaps in terms of the climate agenda with the presidency that the United Kingdom has on COP26, the Vice Minister mentioned the forest, you know, commitments that have been made under the Climate Change Convention, and she suggested some global plan for wetlands. So do you see what could be done also within the framework of the Convention on Climate Change and under the presidency of of the United Kingdom. Do you have any suggestion of what else can be done in that context to raise, you know, the awareness of these important ecosystems that are hotspots of mitigation, you know, very efficient and at the same time so important for resilience? So do you have any more ideas on that?
Always. No, I mean, what I would like to say is, firstly, thank you to the Vice Minister actually for acknowledging, I think, that COP26 was as blue a COP as any that had previously taken place, if not more blue, if that makes sense. I think that reflects very much a determination on the part of the UK to put nature and nature-based solutions right at the heart of our efforts to tackle climate change in a way that I don't think previous COPs necessarily have done so. And that also, Vice Ministers, I think you acknowledged, comes through in the broad support of behind, for example, the Glasgow Declaration on Forest and Land Use, which over 144 countries have signed up to, the effort that we were putting into the oceans agenda, including through our leadership of the Global Oceans Alliance and our co-chair of the High Ambition Coalition on Oceans and Land, the 30 by 30 campaigns. So we are really committed as COP president to ensuring that nature and biodiversity and action on those is central to the wider conversation around climate change, including during the course of our year or during the course of our presidency over the months ahead. I would come back to my earlier point. I think what we need to be better at is looking at the upcoming opportunities on the international agenda over the course of the next few months and thinking through what specifically do we want each of them to deliver on this issue, on the agenda. And then how do we tie all of that together into a coherent strand of activity that perhaps raises the prominence of and lands the issue of wetlands at COP27. In a more high-profile manner. And I think that is something that is incumbent upon those countries such as mine and Costa Rica that are really engaged in this issue and feel passionate about the wetlands issue, to think a little bit more strategically about how can we ensure that we are pushing this issue as high up the international agenda as we can and using every opportunity to do so.
Thank you, Ambassador. And it's important, you mentioned it, but it's really important for me also to echo that this is the first time that in a COP on climate change, nature-based solutions appears, you know, like in the main outcome. And that was really a big achievement that I think that all of us, you know, like celebrating, and it's really an important place to build up. And as you say, this is a year where we are going to have many opportunities, including UNEA, also the Global Biodiversity Framework, where, you know, the contributions of wetlands to biodiversity are huge. We are going to have the Ocean Summit. We are going to have the Climate Change Convention, COP, of course, our convention in November. So it's really a good point, you know, like to make from this discussion to all the parties and all the actors. How can we, you know, connect and raise the awareness about wetlands? So I am going to just read. We've been collecting some of the questions from the audience, and there is one. That is, how can we find a good balance of food production, particularly in developing countries, with the protection of wetlands? So who would like to speak about it? Can I ask perhaps Lisa and the Vice Minister to comment on this? Lisa?
Yes, thank you. And thank you for the question. From my perspective, I think it's really critical that we ensure that dialogues to strengthen policies take place and are facilitated based on the strong scientific evidence that we have of how wetlands can be used and managed to support agriculture and maintain to support those wider ecosystem services while minimizing degradation, pollution. Just ensuring that we undertake coordinated action across the sectors, so the water and wetlands and agricultural sector, instead of having discussions in silos. So it's really that strengthen policy dialogue, strengthen discussions across sectors, and looking at building on the science we have in terms of understanding how to maintain and support the ecosystem services while minimizing the degradation, the loss, the pollution. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rebello. Vice Minister, do you want to comment on that?
Yes, thank you. I think agriculture needs to come up with better solutions. And we have actually worked with them throughout this last couple of years with the NAMA Coffee and the NAMA for the livestock. And these programs are basically using less water in order to conduct your less water and less chemicals in order to conduct your activities, your agricultural activities. So it's not only the expansion of the agricultural land use, but it's also the good practices that they can implement. So I think it will be very important to start to talk about indicators to have. At COP26, I had the opportunity to sit with very young people that are working in developing all this information, both satellite and insight with robotics. And they have this robots that can give us the indicators and the information that we need to come up with global indicators that might give us clues on what the next actions can be and raise awareness as well. Because one part is raising the awareness and the other part is having a plan, an action plan. And I think I couldn't agree more with Dr. Rivella when she said that we're working in silos, basically, and that's where we need to raise the conversation. It's about water security, it's about biodiversity, and it's about climate change. And we need to tackle this, the three of them, with a very ambitious plan. And for us, it has been working very well. And also the product that comes out of NAMA, it's a product that could be recognized and have special value as in our case, premium coffee for the rest of the world. And it's about having a product that is more resilient to climate change, that really considers less use of water and of course, less use of chemicals, and making the connections as well. Where does this, it's not only the use of water that this, the agriculture part is using, but it's also about where this goes to, and it goes right to the ocean. So we need to raise the conversation. And you mentioned in the One Ocean Summit, which I think the discussion is going to be very, very important on and marine litter. And it's also about the chemicals that these waters carry out to the ocean and the connectivity. And the ambassador mentioned as well, the High Ambition Coalition for People and Nature and the 30 by 30 initiative. This is an initiative that basically what we're trying to do there is to connect the 30% protection that we do inland with the 30% protection we do in the ocean. And how is that connected and how is affected by all the actions taken inland to this water bodies that are sometimes addressed in silos, as the doctor mentioned. So I would think that mostly, as I said previously, it's about raising the discussion of connecting these very important ecosystems and also raising awareness through education and better practices.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Vice Minister. So I think that this panel has been extremely useful in terms of showing not only national experience and that we know the connection and we know how to do it, but also highlighting these important connections between agendas, which I think is the main take message from this conversation, as well as the importance of linking to these global agendas that the ambassador described very well, and the whole issue of raising awareness. So raising awareness in the public, which is what we are trying to do today with World Wetlands Day and in the coming days, especially the 2nd of February, but also how can we build, and ambassador, you made this very strong point on how to build awareness within the decision makers, you know, in the different processes on this great opportunity that wetlands provide. So I would like to, unless anyone would like to add anything from the panelists, I would like to thank you very much for this, all these insights. And with this, we are going to move to our second panel. So I will ask our second panel to turn on the cameras. So the second session is about wetland challenges and opportunities for action. And here we are very fortunate to have two panelists who are going to bring perspectives from a different angle. And we have Mr. Onno van der Heuvel, who's the global manager of the Biodiversity Finance Initiative of the United Nations Development Programme. A very interesting, a very practical experience that is having impact on the ground. And we have Ms. Patricia Zurita, who's the Chief Executive Officer of BirdLife International, which is one of the largest partnerships of organizations around the world working on birds, biodiversity, and sustainable development. So with this, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. And I'm going to start with Mr. van der Heuvel. So welcome and thank you so much for joining us. So you work in a project called Biofin, and that you're going to explain our audience what it is about. But this is having quite a big impact because you're working with 40 countries worldwide with different stakeholders from government, from civil society, to develop financial plans. So this is, we were talking before about the importance of finance, and this is really a good example of finance on the ground. So could you please tell us a little bit about how can countries take action to increase financing for wetlands? And if you could share from the Biofin initiative, interesting experiences that show how that can happen.
Well, thank you so much for that question. Real great pleasure to be here. And I think more attention for wetlands is certainly needed in the world of finance. So I'm also hoping to learn a lot, and already learned quite a bit in this meeting. And I would like to first put this in a bigger perspective, because around the world, we are spending around $120 billion on biodiversity conservation. And that sounds like quite a significant amount. But we have to compare that to two other numbers. First of all, we need around 5 times this amount to achieve all of our global biodiversity goals. So we're still quite off the mark. And second, from there, it gets kind of worse. The OECD has calculated we spent around $500 billion on things that harm nature. So our philosophy on financing is that we always have to look at those two numbers. We need to increase the biodiversity positive investment, but also see how we can reduce the biodiversity negative investments. Now, what we do at Biofin, as you said, it's a very practical program. We work with national governments, but also at the subnational level, to develop financing strategies. And these are developed through a broad consultation process with a strong role for ministries of finance. They should be the new conservation hero rather than only ministries of environment, who are, of course, doing also a lot. And this involves also both the public and the private sector. And this follows a quite, let's say, complex process that is described in our Biofin methodology. I will not go into any of those details, but you can find it on our website. And so 40 countries have already started this process. And I just want to share a few examples of what countries have done related to wetlands, which I can say is actually, in my view, not enough. As I screened the list of work that we're doing that relates to wetland, there are quite a few things, but I think there should be much more opportunities that we haven't explored. But just to give you some idea, in India, we are working in all the way in the north, in Sikkim, at Lake Guru Dongmar, which is one of the highest lakes in the world. And we're working there to help introduce a sustainable tourism fee. That means that each tourist will pay a relatively small amount, and that amount will be then used for things like restoration and, you know, any environmental challenge that they face. In Costa Rica, and was already a little bit referred to by the vice minister, we work to help transform the system of payment for ecosystem services, which has so far focused a lot on forestry, to see how that system in particular can play more of a role in wetlands, so that it can benefit wetlands. And in Guatemala, we work with local municipalities. We have worked already on public budgeting to increase the budget for coastal protection, but now we are working to develop a proposal, an investment proposal for one municipality on mangrove protection that's going to be submitted for next year's budget. And in Colombia, we work on a proposal of $3 million investment with 7 municipalities to use royalties as an investment in wetlands, the royalties from things like mining. And the last example, and I'm just walking through a few different ones, I thought it's best to illustrate what we do. In Belize, we are working on a business and investment framework for the protected areas. And of course, several of those are wetlands, and among those are two Ramsar sites. And the idea is to generate more revenue for those protected areas. So these are some examples, and there are definitely more. And I was very inspired to hear also from the UK their lessons, and I hope I can find them somewhere on the internet to add them to our knowledge management streams. And we have actually documented all the different finance solutions in what we call the catalog of finance solutions. And we found there are more than 150 finance solutions that can be used for biodiversity. Now, maybe not all of them could be applicable to wetlands, but I hope people around the world have a look at this and can be inspired. And I would dare to say that a lot of them, in fact, can benefit wetlands. So that's very briefly our approach and some examples. And I think it illustrates that there are a lot of different options, and we have to involve a lot of different stakeholders. And yes, we need to do more for wetlands. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's really interesting because this is looking from another perspective, but it joins on some of the comments that were made before. So you have had the opportunity to be looking in a very practical and specific way of, you know, how this can be done in different countries. So could you share with us which do you think are the main challenges, you know, for countries to get access to needed finance? And do you have any ideas on how this could be overcome?
Yes, I think, I mean, for wetlands in particular, but also for a lot of conservation projects in general, one fundamental challenge when you look at finance is scale. The scale of having a lot of local projects that doesn't match to the very big international finance flows. This is something you see in investment, like big investors. They don't do this kind of small investment projects. And even if you look at things like ODA or green bonds or even national budgets, there's sort of a need to bring some kind of intermediate framework that connects projects at the local side with what's happening at the national as well at the international level. And one useful approach that can be used is what we're trying to look at more as well is financing plans at the landscape level, which could be more suitable for wetlands. And I think a related structure is also if you look at governance of wetlands. So they are often part of national protected area systems, or they're run by local governments and not necessarily, again, empowered to be involved in the national debate. And within the issue of governance, number one challenge that many parks face is actually the issue of retention. Actually, many wetlands and other protected areas generate a lot of revenue, but because of fiscal rules, they're not allowed to keep this revenue. Instead, they have to pass it on to Treasury, where it becomes sort of invisible. And so I think there's actually an opportunity there for the international community to say, hey, look, this is all the revenue coming from protected areas. Let's make sure it goes back into those protected areas, because they are very important for people, for nature, and for our economies. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It is very interesting because, as you say, we often think about the money that we need, you know, like for what we know is needed in terms of conservation, sustainable use, and restoration of wetlands. But you're also talking about all the investment that are done on activities that damage wetlands. So this suggests that there is a need to look at the whole financial issue in a more comprehensive way. And as you were saying, also looking at the question of scale. And perhaps this is a good segue to just turn to our next speaker, Patricia Zurita, because BirdLife International and the work that you have been leading also shows potential and how, you know, can an organization that comes from the civil society, but that has managed, you know, like to work with others across the globe, how are you tackling this question of scale? How are you tackling this question of how to get the level of change and transformation and action on wetlands from the perspective of a big and important international organization that is made up of a coalition of many smaller organizations. So can you share that with us?
Yes, thank you so much, Martha, for having me. And hi, everybody. I'm Patricia Zurita. I'm the chief executive of BirdLife International. BirdLife is the largest partnership for nature, and we are actually turning 100 this year, and hence the logo on my Zoom background. We bring together over 118 organizations from around the world, all of them conservation organizations, national conservation organizations on their own right, but they all choose to be part of the BirdLife family, partly because we share our love for birds, but because we also recognize the role that they play as indicators for the rest of nature and the rest of the planet. As we heard, the world's wetlands are in sharp decline, and they're incredibly important sites for birds. Not only we have lost tremendous amounts of sites that are wetlands, but with them, 17% of the water bird species are now threatened because of that. We have identified through our important birds and biodiversity area criteria more than 4,000 sites that have incredible importance for birds that are wetlands of the 13,000 sites around the world. So it's, if you think about it, it's an important proportion of the sites that are important for nature that are wetlands. And over 700 of these 4,000 have been recognized by the Ramsar Convention. And that's one of the roles that the BirdLife family has, is really raising up the level of knowledge and awareness that these wetlands play in their own country, so they can actually be recognized nationally, but also by the Ramsar Convention. I just want to give you a couple of examples of how we're trying to tackle scale, because scale is at different levels. We have to make sure that our partners across the world are helping us protect and restore these wetlands. And there are a series of different examples that I want to just mention here. One, for example, when there's a whole area of work where we have been ensuring that development is done in the best way possible, ensuring that there's no harm to wetlands. For example, in Montenegro, our partner ZIZIP successfully blocked the construction and the transformation of the old Sin Salina, that is a very important wetland in the coast, ensuring that the government could help protect nationally the salt pans and maintain the salt production that is absolutely crucial for biodiversity and for the maintenance of that wetland. And we successfully, with your support, Marta, were able to get that site nominated as a Ramsar site. We very much believe on the role of working with local communities. They are the stewards of these sites. And for example, in Nigeria, BirdLife has been funding a local women's charity to promote mangrove and agroforestry, ensuring that we can sustain livelihoods and stabilize the coast. And one of the things that I want to make sure that it comes across clearly, and this has been mentioned throughout this session, how important wetlands are as a connector of multiple different things. And perhaps one of the things that we haven't mentioned yet, I mean, we've talked about climate, we have talked about the role of wetlands as nature-based solutions. We've talked about biodiversity, of course, we've talked about water and ecosystem services and livelihoods and sustaining the development goals that we want to have. But we haven't talked about migration and the critical role that wetlands play in the migration of species, not only birds, but also coastal and marine species. And I think some of the examples that BirdLife has been working with, the Gomes estuary, for example, in the Republic of Korea, we are in a massive campaign trying to protect this area because of the role that it plays in the East Asian Australasian flyway. So then let me take you to scale, because I think this is exactly where we need to go. BirdLife International is a partnership in collaboration and with the Asian Development Bank and the East Asian Australasian Flyway Partnership Secretariat, launched in October at the COP, at the Biodiversity COP, and then in November at the Climate COP, the East Asian Australasian Flyway Initiative. And this is a $3 billion initiative to conserve and restore between 50 and 100 wetlands across the flyway. And so it's basically using the migration as an organizing principle, but using wetlands and the network of the wetlands throughout the flyway as an opportunity to bring together climate, nature, and development. And the funding that comes into this and on thinking about creative funding is blending finance that comes from both public and private sector that is dedicated to all these different three different agendas. So we are super excited about this initiative, of course, but we see this as one of the opportunities of truly scaling up the results and the action for wetlands, ensuring that we can, over the next 20 years, have functional, rehabilitated, protected, conserved, managed wetlands that are not only sustaining the migration of these amazing birds, we're talking about over 50 million birds that used, of 200 species that use this flyway, but particularly, and as the Vice Minister was speaking about, providing jobs to people. The minute that we are actually protecting these wetlands and restoring them especially, we are creating jobs and we're maintaining areas where local livelihoods can be sustained. So it is an incredibly important opportunity. We are excited about this initiative because while we launched it in Asia and it's basically connecting, you know, the flyway that goes from Alaska and Russia all the way down to New Zealand and Australia, it is something that can be replicated in the other flyways of the world. There are eight major flyways, and we're already in conversations with our partners in the other regions to make sure that that happens. And the majority of these flyways are comprised by a very solid composition of wetlands and landscapes, and in some cases, seascapes. Just to finish, I would like to say that one, BirdLife is incredibly proud to be an international organization partner of the Ramsar Convention, and we're looking forward to continuing our work together with you and with the convention, including the COP in Wuhan, and during this decade of ecosystem restoration to ensure that we can safeguard and restore wetlands across the world. And that we very much value working with you and the parties to deliver solutions for wetlands at scale, using the Flyway Initiative, for example, but all the other experiences of the BirdLife family across the world. And that we truly hope that this can be an opportunity where we can start connecting the dots and using, you know, the same principle of the migration that uses all of the connecting places to be alive, just connecting all of these different conventions and all of these different commitments, because we have commitments for climate, we have commitments for biodiversity, we have commitments for wetlands, we have commitments for migration. How can we make sure that we're having one cohesive agenda? And I'm very much looking forward, and we're working very actively on ensuring that the global biodiversity framework that will be launched by the Convention of Biological Diversity, hopefully this year, will include really strong ties to the Climate COP, to the Ramsar Convention, and to the CMS. And I can only echo the voice of Ambassador Woodruff, and as well as the Vice Minister Barsuna in Costa Rica. We do need to work together. We need to make sure that we are connecting all of these commitments and ensuring that we're leveraging them so then they can be complied with, and that we can have results in this decade that is absolutely critical for the planet and for our future. So with that, just let me finish thanking you again for having us. Happy Wetlands Day on Wednesday. We will be celebrating very loud and clear with you all, but we are delighted to make our experience and our knowledge and our, you know, the fantastic local and indigenous knowledge that BirdLife has around the world to put it to the service of the parties and whoever wants to, you know, ensure that wetlands are alive now and in the future.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Patricia. This is really a very good example of the power of partnerships, which I think you have highlighted in a very strong way. And also this connection that we had not mentioned, which is the connection, you know, between the ecosystems and migratory birds are absolutely the example of this, because without these stopping places, migration cannot take place. we are coming to the end, but I would like to just ask a very quick question that came from the audience. I cannot resist, sorry. And I'm going to ask Patricia very briefly, because we only have 5 minutes left to respond it. And it's, could panelists comment on the plan for implementing a gender lens on wetland conservation on behalf of women who are often at the bottom of the pyramid and directly rely on wetlands as a source of livelihoods? So if you could tell us in 2 minutes, your reflections. I prefer to cut on my concluding remarks because I think that this is really an important issue.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And as I was mentioning this example in Nigeria, it is specifically about giving women the opportunity of having jobs generating and regenerating mangroves and mangrove areas. I think, you know, wetlands are the provisor of loads of different things, not only ecosystem services, fresh water, and you know, adaptation to climate change, but they're extraordinary sources of food. I mean, these are the places where we fish. These are the places where our coastal areas are actually replenished. These are the areas where we harvest our clams. And I am Ecuadorian originally, and a lot of my work was related to wetlands, whether they were freshwater forests, flooded forests in the Amazon, or whether they were mangroves in the Pacific. And there is a huge connection of wetlands and women. And women, in many, many cases, are the harvesters of that seafood, for example, in those wetlands, those coastal wetlands. They are the ones who are seeing the challenges and the changes on these ecosystems. But also they are they have an extraordinary opportunity, and we have the responsibility of empowering these women communities and those communities and the women within the communities to ensure that wetlands continue to provide for them, but that in thinking about restoring and conserving these wetlands, they play a pivotal role in terms of providing their indigenous knowledge, their experience, but also them driving the change to ensure that these wetlands are protected in the future.
Thank you, Patricia. And as well, you know, like the role of women as leaders, actors of change, scientists, and we were happy to have Dr. Rivello, to have you and the vice minister. So it's also a good opportunity to highlight the important role of gender, you know, in mainstreaming, being mainstreamed. And actually the convention has had the first resolution linking gender and wetlands for those of you who are interested. So we are finishing and running out of time, but I wanted to thank you very much, both of you, for these very interesting insights on what can be done. And I would like just to close by making a couple of final remarks, very short. I think that we had a very rich panel discussion because we actually identified some key points that I would like just to very quickly highlight. We know the situation of wetlands, we know the opportunities, and I think that it was highlighted for wetlands to be used as part of the solutions, as nature-based solutions to many of the problems that the world is facing, biodiversity loss, climate change, unsustainability, et cetera. And some key things that came out are about the connections with water, with cities, with agriculture, the connection between inland waters and sea, the connection with the floods, the connections with migration, as you were highlighting, Patricia. We talked also about mechanisms like urban planning, restoration, financial instruments such as payment for ecosystem services, the importance of including wetlands in the national action plans under the Convention on Climate Change, the need to know where wetlands are with inventories, the critical importance of having people at the center, community-based approaches, how wetlands contribute to jobs and to the economy, the importance of site measures, and we heard quite a number of examples. Finance, a very important question, you know, like an issue. And we heard some experiences from the national level, from the United Kingdom, as well as initiatives like UNDPs with the challenges of scale and the also the practice that we know how to do it and what are the challenges and how to overcome them. And importantly, the importance of partnerships, how everybody needs to get together. The other point was the importance of looking at the policy opportunities that are coming up with UNEA 5, with the post-20 biodiversity framework that has to include wetlands, the climate change agenda, the Ocean Summit, the EU proposal to UNEA on nature-based solutions. So all these, I think that all these shows and reinforce the message of World Wetlands Day, which is about the urgency to take action, to say that we know what is needed, we have the experiences, and what we need is to scale all this. And we really hope that World Wetlands Day is this moment where we can raise awareness, share this knowledge, and get the level of action and commitment so that we can conserve, restore, and use wisely this ecosystem on which we all depend. So with this World Wetlands Day, to everybody, thank you to the panelists, thank you to the audience for participating, and thank you for all the work that so many people are doing to save this important ecosystem. So thank you very much.